Welcome to Shiloh, the bane of every Union campaigner's existence. We're playing on Major General Difficulty with the JMP mod. Unlike other battles in this series, I will be turning the AI scaling back to the base of 1 for Shiloh, rather than the 1.3 that we've been playing with. I may be crazy, but I'm not a masochist. I will actually be posting two Shiloh battles with very different tactics. The first one will be a mobile forces approach that I'm using as part of this campaign. The second one will be using my previous training-focused army, holding both the left and right flanks in a you-shall-not-pass all-out brawl for a day one victory and not falling back to the Hornet's Nest or Pittsburgh landing. Before we jump right into camp, I want to talk a little bit about why Shiloh is such a pain for most players. In my opinion, it can be argued that in all five battles prior to Shiloh, the Union has the advantage in one way or the other. At Shiloh, the Confederates got all of their army in the first two phases, whereas the player has to make do with just a small portion. The Confederate units are bigger and have more unit perks. The only Union advantage is the fact that they're defending rather than attacking. The deployment screen shows the Confederates with 50,856 soldiers and 148 guns, versus the Union's 44,353 soldiers and 96 guns, which appears to be fairly even. I've had much worse odds playing the previous battles with AI scaling at 1.3. But the Confederates get all 50,000 troops plus their guns in the first two phases. On the Union side, Buell's force is over 22,000 strong with more than 30 guns. So that's over half of your forces won't appear until the next day. So you are outgunned by more than 2-1 when you reach the Hornet's Nest, and even more than that during the first two phases for the left and right flanks. In a previous video, I mentioned that part of the AI's logic is that the more it outnumbers you, the more likely it is to charge. Well, at Shiloh, the AI sees charging as the solution to every problem. One way to deal with the charges is to use a mobile force to harass the enemy, cause diversions, and move out of the way when the AI charges. So that's what I'll be doing in this battle. Taking a look at the army I've assembled, 1st Corps has my Brigadier General, who is the closest to getting the Major General, and he has an accuracy perk. 1st Division has Erwin McDowell, who I hired using reputation points. I have 3 cavalry and 3 skirmishers in 1st Division, and all 6 of them will deploy on the Union right at the beginning of the battle. William Sherman has 2nd Division, who I also took with reputation points. The first 3 units in the division will deploy to the Union left, and the last 3 units will go to the Union right at the beginning of the battle. The size of my new units is partly determined by weapons availability and partly by the level of the officer that's assigned. Third Division is commanded by my avatar. I also created a few dedicated melee infantry brigades, which will get melee perks all the way through the campaign, along with the best melee weapons I can give them. All 3 infantry here will deploy to the left flank at the start of the second phase. The 3 skirmishers will deploy at the start of Hornet's Nest. I won't need all of the skirmishers that I've created for the mobile force at Shiloh here once this is over. However, even with training maxed, skirmisher and cavalry vets are expensive, so rather than buying vets to replenish their losses, I will merge some of those units together. William Brewster has 4th Division. All of the guns in this division will deploy once the Hornet's Nest phase begins. I don't want any guns to deploy in the first two phases because I'm going to be moving units faster than my guns can keep up. Thus, all of my guns will deploy with the infantry around a defensive line north of the Hornet's Nest. I hired a Brigadier General to lead the 2nd Corps and gave him an accuracy perk. John Gibbon has 1st Division with 3 of my 2-star units. The first 5 brigades in this division will deploy as reinforcements to the right flank. However, rather than rushing forward, they will begin forming my defensive line that will be critical once the Hornet's Nest phase starts. The skirmisher at the end of this division will deploy with the left flank. Lewis Wagner, the original division commander from the start of the game, has 2nd Division here. Scales, Walton, Stokes, and Vaughn will deploy on the left flank at the start of the second phase. The other two units will deploy at the Hornet's Nest. Third Division is led by William Brooks, hired from the Academy. All of this division will deploy with the Hornet's Nest. I've nearly emptied all of my armory. The weapons left over were ones that didn't have enough to build a unit. I have 3 wounded officers in the barracks that I'll get back after Shiloh. My career perks are 10 in training, 6 in AO, and 1 in recon. I used my reputation points to take both of the officers that were available here. Heavy artillery is just too slow for me at Shiloh with the strategy that I'm using, so I'm not taking them. Let me give you an overview of the overall strategy here, then I'll turn the game sound up and jump back in to give comments at the end. The battle will open on the Union right with 9 units comprising of skirmishers and cavalry. They will provide some token resistance while getting in place along the western part of the battlefield. My smaller units will try to isolate and engage some of the Confederate larger units. My cav will steal supply wagons, destroy artillery, and support the skirmishers when needed. When my right flank reinforcements come in, they will start to form a defensive line in the north. I will not engage on the Union left unless I am forced to. My infantry there will prepare to strategically withdraw to the north while my skirmishers and cav sneak down the eastern part of the battlefield and wait for Breckinridge's oversized reinforcement brigades to pass, then we'll fold in behind them and start to hit and run, steal wagons, and take out artillery batteries. The bulk of my infantry and all of my artillery will deploy when the Hornet's Nest phase starts. The Confederates will be hell-bent to take the Hornet's Nest, and they're welcome to it. I will establish a defensive line along the north of the battlefield. The 3 Allied brigades that come in will also take up defensive positions on that line. My goal is to position artillery to release a relentless barrage anytime the Confederate units move north to charge my line. I will rotate my units out as much as I can to manage unit condition. In the meantime, all those skirmishers and cavalry that I positioned to the east and west will now fold in from behind the Confederate army and surround it. The overall strategy is to take away his ammo, destroy his artillery, and raise enough hell in the south that he can't focus solely on my northern line and must commit forces to multiple sides to deal with my hit and runs. Once Pittsburgh Landing opens up, I will withdraw my most damaged units first, followed by my artillery, then my healthier units. I'm going to pause the game here and call this the end of part one, Shiloh, and I'll get the second part loaded as soon as possible. So I'll see you then.